Most of you do not think about why it is so important that we stone the prophet or dreamer of dreams that seeks to lead others to a different path or to a different image of our Creator. Most people think that we are to measure prophets by whether the thing that they have spoken comes to pass or not. This is only part of the measurement, and it is not even the total measurement that we're commanded to use to stone them. Ron Wineland or Harold Camping or others like this do need to be stoned, but not for predicting the wrong date of our Messiah's return by itself, and I will explain. We are commanded to stone them because they seek to teach their followers to follow after a false image of our Elohim. They need to be stoned because they seek to lead others to a different path than the one that was given to us that leads to eternal life. The path that Yeshua became and told us to follow him. In doing so, they are guilty of the spirit of murder. We are commanded to stone them for these reasons, even if their predictions do come to pass. And we are commanded to do likewise to all of the false shepherds who do the same, whether they predict a date or call themselves a prophet or not. The verses that people use about the event needing to come to pass are found in Deuteronomy 18, verses 21 and 22. And if you say in your heart, how will we know if what they have spoken is a word which Yahweh has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in Yahweh's name, if their word does not come to pass, and it is not to come, or something that's to come in the future, it is a word that Yahweh has not spoken, and that prophet has spoken in arrogance, and you shall not abide as part of him. The King James translated the last line as, you shall not fear him, but it is not the word for fear. It is the word that means to sojourn or to abide with, and it is coupled in this verse with the word that means out from or as a part of. He is saying that we are not to walk with or abide with this false prophet, and we are to depart out from this false prophet. In the preceding verses, which I will read in a minute, he says that we are to kill the prophet that speaks a word in his name which he has not commanded them to speak, and which speaks in the name of other Elohims or false images of him. The event not coming to pass is part of the measurement, but the reason for the death penalty is because they speak in the name of false images of him and seek to lead those who will listen to them to a different path. And all other paths besides Yahweh's true path leads to the lake of fire. His word is given to us line upon line, here a little, there a little. I often use the example of how most people love to quote John 3:16 without reading or quoting the following verses that define this verse. If we had Moses record the exclusion that if the event was not something that was yet to come, because all of the prophets, including Yeshua, have prophesied things that still have not come to pass. And sometimes things come to pass, but not even in the same way that the prophet thought that it would, or especially not like those that they prophesied to thought it would come to pass. An example of this is Yeshua saying, destroy this temple in 3 days and I will raise it back up. There are often symbolisms like this in the prophecies, point to things. In any case, the instructions for stoning the false prophet are not because of the event did not come to pass by itself, because the event might still be yet to come. Yet it is certainly part of the measurement when coupled with the rest of what we're to measure them with. In the preceding verses, Yahweh said that he would raise up a prophet to Israel in Deuteronomy 18, backing up to verse 18. And I will raise up a prophet from among their kindred, like I did with you, speaking of Moses. And I will give my words into his mouth, and he will speak to them all that I will command him. And it will come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he will speak in my name, I will make inquisition of with him. People write me and tell me that they are not going to follow what any man speaks. I agree that we are not to follow any man, but when Yahweh Elohim puts his word into a man's mouth, you had better to hearken, because it is not this man's word. And so few have hearkened to what any of his prophets have spoken. This is evident. Over time, they have killed them and stoned them and let the false prophets flourish in their midst. And this is still true today. You will seek to kill me because he has put his word in my mouth, and you loathe his word. You loathe his righteousness that his word testifies to. Even though you say you believe his word and love it, you lie to yourself, a bunch of liars and hypocrites, except for a small flock. And obviously in these videos, the small flock knows I'm not talking about them anyhow. So few of you who have heard what he has bid you to do would even do a couple of simple things like stop eating the bread of men or cover your heads. It is plainly recorded in his word that I would be sent with these commandments, and his word testifies that you ought to have been doing them anyway. Nearly none of you would offer up the offering in righteousness that he has proclaimed for you to offer up to him at this time. If you are to return to him, because you refuse to return to him on his terms, you want to tell him how it is, just invent another way. He sent me to you bearing irrefutable proof in his word that he has sent me, so it is not that you are not hearkening to me. You are not hearkening to him because you are not hearkening to his word. Verse 20, but if there is a prophet which speaks proudly in a word in my name which I have not commanded him to speak, and which speaks in the name of other Elohims or other false images of him, that prophet shall be put to death. So there's a reason why we're to put someone to death. The death penalty emphasis is on speaking in the name of other Elohims, saying it's from him. In the following verse where he says the event did not come to pass, you are to remove yourself from that false prophet. In Deuteronomy chapter 13, he says that even if the event comes to pass, we are to stone them for teaching a different path or a different image of him. Deuteronomy 13 verse 5, it says, put to death that prophet or dreamer of dreams because he or she spoke to cause you to rebel against Yahweh Elohim, which brought you out of the land of Egypt and released you out of the house of bondage, because he or she has sought to draw you out from the pathway which Yahweh Elohim commanded us to walk on. Burn away the evil from your midst, he says. I will use false prophet Ron Wineland for an example. Most have not heard of Ron yet, but he is still positioned to become known to the world in the coming time of calamity. His father Satan led him to prophesy that his make-believe Jagai would return on the Feast of First Fruits this year. The real Messiah will return on the feast, so technically Ron's prophecy will come to pass even. Yet he is clearly false because he teaches and represents a different path than the path that Yahweh Elohim gave us to walk on with him on. And of course, Ron doesn't know when the Feast of First Fruits is. He thinks it passed a few days ago, and it's not for 52 more days anyhow. And he just moved his prophecy to next year now anyhow, and I'm not going to go into all that, but he certainly has just stayed in a position to continue to ride the signs of the time as they increase. Ron represents and teaches a perversion to the path that was given to us to walk on. Why are we commanded to exercise such a stiff penalty as stoning for what he and others like him have done? It is because they lead people to the lake of fire, and this is murder. Ron's prophecy failed a few days ago when he was not found dead in the streets of Jerusalem and resurrected 3.5 days later. And I will tell you why he needs to be stoned. It is because he did not repent and throw himself on Yahweh Elohim's mercy seat. He has chosen to continue to lead his flock and whosoever else will he can gather into his flock to the lake of fire. And this angers me. It's evil. And it angers my father. Looking forward to Ron getting introduced to the hailstones. He will still be one of Satan's many voices riding the coming calamity. He's set up to do so, and our creator's allowed for this. Just to test you, to see who you're going to believe, who will you listen to. But what is he telling people to do? He will be leading them to a false path, therefore to the lake of fire. If someone is killing thousands of people, what should you do to them? Our creator says to stone them so that others will fear doing as they have done. He says that we are to be the first to grab a stone. What would you have done with those in Syria who were murdering those children the other day? One even with a pacifier in his mouth. Would you pat them on the back and tell them to march on? What is the difference with a false shepherd who is leading his flock to the lake of fire? There is no difference other than the murder is not immediate. It's a little slower motion. Same difference. The same is true of all of you parents who do not teach your children our Creator's path like He commanded us to. I have people who write to me and tell me that I am the one who is the false prophet. What have I spoken to for you to do that is not commanded by the other prophets? What have I commanded for you to do that Yeshua Himself did not testify to? Recently, some things have been magnified, like that even touching the spiritually dead is the same thing as touching a dead body. But which of you can refute that the scripture does not testify that this magnification is not proclaimed in His word, precept upon precept? You can't, because it is. His word testifies to itself, backs it up. And where is there another prophet that has come forth with the red heifer and the water separation for touching the dead person physically anyway? Did the commandment to wash with this water go away? Of course not. And now it is being restored and magnified to show that 96.6667% of the world needs to be purged out from the earth because they're unclean and dead before our Creator. Isaiah recorded that the first witness would magnify the Torah. He said in Isaiah 42:21, if he is well pleased for His righteousness' sake, He will magnify the Torah and make it honorable, or make it glorious and magnificent. I've always quoted this verse, applying it to Yeshua. He entered into the final stone to complete the temple. He continues to magnify the Torah through the second witness. This verse flows right into the here and the now with the second witness. In the following verse, He says in verse 22, but this is a people that are robbed and plundered. They are snared in the serpent's holes, and they are all hiding in the prison houses. They are for a plunder, and none delivers them from the spoil, and none saith to turn back to repent. Who among you will give ear to this? Who will hearken and obey that which was? It was prophesied that one would be sent in the spirit of Elijah to restore the paths of old and to turn the people to having hearts like the hearts of the patriarchs. This verse is for the here and the now. It applies to now. Israel is plundered and spoiled by the abomination of desolation, and they are hiding in the captivity of the beast. And like going back into the verse 21 back there, where it says that the Torah will be magnified and brought forward by one who Yeshua would enter into, is what this all fits into, the prophecy. That's what I've been sent to do as well, to magnify the Torah, Him in me, giving, restoring what is being restored. Verse 24, who gave Jacob to be plundered and Israel to be robbers? Did not Yahweh do this to you who have sinned? Because you would not walk in His pathways, neither would you obey His Torah. Folks, I am telling you to get as far away from these two-bit phony prophets and false shepherds as you can. If they are not teaching you to do the least of the commandments, like wearing blue tassels on the borders of your clothes, all the way to the greatest of them, which is loving Yahweh Elohim with your entire life, then flee from their filth, or you will die with them. And loving Yahweh with your entire life is loving His true image. His true image is not Ron Wineland's image of Him that says that you must conform to some list of 57 truths that he and his predecessor put together. Ron's image of Him is the abomination of desolation, Saul of Tarsus's image of Him. We must measure all against Yahweh's word, including our own beliefs and anyone that we listen to. You should not marvel that the false Messiah, Jose Miranda, says that all of the writings of the prophets are void and that we only need to obey Saul's writings. You just think about it. Ron teaches out of Saul's writings. All these false prophets do, except for actually one that I know that he hasn't really risen to the scene, and I don't know that he's going to, but he teaches a perversion of the Torah, the Jewish traditions and stuff anyhow. But point is all of these, most of them are actually in the Saturday Sabbath camp. But you know, I think Jose is a Sunday person, and I think Rael is a Sunday person, but a lot of the false prophets that are on the scene are still in the Saturday camp. And anyway, and there's even lots of false shepherds that understand when the Sabbaths are, but I'm not going to go into all that. I'm using Ron for example here today because he did not go away along with his failed prophecy, which I knew he would not. He simply used his failed prophecy to poise himself to continue to deceive people. And for this reason, he needs to be stoned. The measuring rod is Yahweh's word. It is not a fabricated list that includes a bunch of lies, a bunch of false signs that Satan has set up. One of the big lies on this false prophet's list is the Saturday Sabbath abomination. And this is a pretty big one. It's a sign between Yahweh Elohim and his people. All that any of us needs to do is believe Elohim's word to know the truth on this subject. You actually have to reject his word in order to believe that the Sabbath is on a fixed day of the week on Satan's Roman calendar. I stand boldly with his word and in agreement with his word to declare that all of the false prophets and false shepherds must either repent or dying they will die. They must die so that they are no longer able to lead others to the lake of fire. It's not going to be allowed in the millennium. Satan and his crew will be bound, and his servants are going to be purged from the earth so that Yahweh's will finally be done on earth as it is in heaven. What will most of you have in your hearts toward me because I have spoken this? You will think that I am the evil one who needs to die, and soon you will be allowed to kill me. This is because you are a people that calls evil good and good evil. 96.667% of you will have this in your hearts anyhow, to different degrees. But until then, until I'm able to be killed, I will stand before my Father and his Son, magnifying his Torah and making it honorable, as was prophesied to happen. I stand before him declaring that the end of man's error is nearly over. And if you do not turn from your rebellion to him, dying you will die. If you are still alive on July 19th and you have not repented, you will be stoned with hailstones, the weight of a talent, along with all of the false prophets and the false shepherds who feed their flocks for the slaughter. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim.